Before we broke in the last video, we were talking about MEMS accelerometers, and we had figured out how to make an accelerometer which could measure acceleration around the X and along the Y direction. And the main concept was to use this proof mass which could move along the X direction, and this another proof mass which is perpendicular to the first one, which is confined and is free to move along the Y direction. And we thought, you know, we could lay these out together on one single chip, as is shown over here, with a set of fingers and fixed plates, which would measure the acceleration in the X direction, and a perpendicularly laid set of fins and plates, which would measure it along the Y direction. The next question was how to make a three-axis accelerometer, for which we would need to measure acceleration along the z-axis. So one way to go about it would be essentially to take this chip and just flip it 90 degrees, okay? So one of these fins, which was, you know, one of these moving mass which had fins, which was moving, which was maybe measuring acceleration along the Y direction, would be now facing up, and it could now measure acceleration along the Z axis. While this is theoretically certainly possible, there are many problems in taking approach like that. We can think about how to make contacts, or how to connect to this MEMS chip, which is perpendicular, and that would become very challenging. Also, how to overall package these two chips into one monolithic package would become increasingly difficult if this chip is, you know, standing perpendicular with respect to the ground. So, even though this might sound like a cool thing to do, it's not a very practical approach. So the practical approach, which is most commonly used to make a three-axis accelerometer, or to enable measurement of acceleration along the z-axis, is this concept of this mass, which is suspended using what's called as a torsion bar or a torsion spring. And the idea is pretty simple. So the idea is you have a large set of area which is dedicated to this upper capacitor plate, which is suspended above the substrate using this torsion bar. And the main idea is that the moments of this upper capacitor plate are unevenly distributed with respect to this axis of the torsion bar. So as you can see in this picture over here, this upper capacitor plate has much more mass located towards the right as compared to the mass it has located towards the left of the plate. So whenever there's an acceleration along the z-axis, there'll be an imbalance of the moments along these torsion bar, and that would result in one part of the plate going down and accordingly another part of the plate lifting up. So to describe it more clearly, I will draw the cross-section, the side cross-section. So if I take a side cross-section of this upper capacitor plate, it would look something like this. Okay, so I have this torsion bar over here, and then I have these two masses unequally distributed. So whenever I have an acceleration, this will essentially bend like this. Okay, so the part which has higher mass will go down, and the part which has lower mass will go up. And I can use that to my leverage to measure the acceleration. If I design a capacitor by using this upper capacitor plate, and I would lay down on the ground like this fixed ground planes which measure these two capacitances. So now I would have essentially one capacitance which is going up with this motion, and another capacitance which is going down because this distance is increasing. And again, I can sense the change in capacitance as this plate bends around this torsion bar. Okay, so an important thing for this to happen is that this area of this top capacitor plate has to be significant so that I can have a significant change in the capacitance. So you will notice that in these three-axis accelerometer, using this concept, a lot of the area on the chip is dedicated to making this z-axis accelerometer. So I'm showing here one of these pictures. So on this picture, you can clearly see all the three sensors which are measuring acceleration along X, Y, and Z axis. So these set of fins would be, let's say, used for measuring acceleration along the X axis. And then you would have a perpendicular set of fins and fixed plates, which would measure the acceleration along the Y axis. And then you see that you have a large part of the chip which is dedicated to measuring the acceleration along the z-axis. So over here you see this torsion bar or this torsion spring, and you see that this mass is asymmetrically, this upper capacitor plate you can clearly see is asymmetric. There is much more mass along this side of this torsion spring as compared to this side. And a large fraction of the area on the chip is dedicated to making this upper capacitor plate such that you can detect this change of capacitance when this capacitor plate moves. Okay, another thing to keep in mind that this z-axis sensor, the properties of that is the stiffness of this spring, as well as the stiffness, as well as the mass, the proof mass of this spring, is going to be different as compared to these X and Y sensor. Okay, so many a times this mass ends up being larger as compared to the mass that you have, the proof mass that you have for the X and Y direction. As a result of that, the resonant frequency that you get along the Z direction could be different as, or you know, usually lower than the resonant frequency that you get along the X and the Y direction. So what I would encourage you to do is go check out the data sheets of some of these three-axis accelerometer, which list out what is the bandwidth, what is the frequency, and some of the other properties along X, Y, and Z direction. And you will notice that the properties along the Z direction are different as compared to what you have along the X and Y direction. So that's a good hint that, you know, it's indicating that the sensor has been made using this approach. So I'd like to end with this final note, which is around scaling. Since we have studied about scaling in a lot of other videos on this channel, what I would like to also mention is how this MEMS accelerometer has scaled over the years. So this is, you know, drawing this line along as a function of years, and what you see is clearly the size of the MEMS accelerometer has decreased significantly in these last 4 years, and now you are getting accelerometers, three-axis accelerometer, with the overall IC dimension nearing close to mm square. And it started all the way back in 2007, where the dimension of this was around 9 mm square. And you might think why this is a big deal, because you know 9 mm square is 3 mm by 3 mm, as compared to a lot of the accelerometers today are like 2 mm by 2 mm, and increasingly they are approaching 1 mm by 1 mm. Okay. So remember the picture that I showed you, which showed the these MEMS accelerometers and also the gyroscopes in the first video. So there are two things. Once you have your printed circuit board on a phone, you have only an area of typically like 80 mm square available on your printed circuit board. And if you do reduce the size, it does matter a lot. So if you have a chip which is 3 mm by 3 mm, okay, versus if you have a chip which is 1 mm by 1 mm, the routing on this printed circuit board, or the options which are available for placing this 1 mm by 1 mm chip, are usually, you know, 300 or 400 times much better the number of options you have for placing a smaller chip as compared to the number of options you have for placing a larger chip. And this, as you can imagine, would become even more significant once you go to wearable devices, where again the amount of area which is available for placing the chips is again much smaller. So especially for mobile and even especially for wearable applications, the reduction in the die size from 9 mm square to 1 mm square gives you a lot of flexibility in terms of where you can place the chip. You will notice that the consumer electronic based devices, they have reduced this area of the accelerometer much more aggressively as compared to what has been done in these automobile applications, because in an automobile you are not as constrained with space as you are in a consumer electronic application. Okay, the other benefit that you do get as you reduce the size, okay, is this cost reduction. Okay, so you get tremendous amount of cost reduction. So when these accelerometers were first introduced, they used to cost more than 10 cents for a three-axis accelerometer. Now you can get something in the range of 3 cents for a three-axis accelerometer, or that is around 1 cent for measuring acceleration along each of these axes. And again, that's, you know, that makes a huge impact in terms of the volume shipments of these accelerometer and the amount of penetration that they have in your phones and all other consumer electronics. So as a result of scaling the size of these accelerometer, it has further enabled the adoption of these things in all sort of devices. So I'd like to leave you with a final thought. We have talked about scaling with respect to transistor, where we have seen the performance of the transistor, it improves as you scale down the area of the transistor, as you scale down the lateral dimension of each transistor. The final food of thought that I want to leave you with is, think about what would happen to the performance of a MEMS accelerometer as you scale down its area. So as you can think, the proof mass will decrease, or the dimensions in that capacitor assembly that we talked about will decrease. So think about what would happen to the performance or the specs of an accelerometer as you scale down its dimension. And we'll come and touch base on this topic in the subsequent questions and in another videos. Thanks.